All praise. Good to hear all you brothers and sisters this day. Topic again. It's called Here's the Catch. How beautiful it is to be in the truth and to know who we are. So let's go to Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. We'll open up with that. Colossians 3 and 17. And it reads, "And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all by Hashem HaMashiach Yahawashi, giving thanks to the Heavenly Father Yahweh by Him." All praises all day long. All praises. One thing about this truth is those of us who are in the truth are thoroughly convinced that we are in the truth, which is the Most High's word, which consists of his commandments, his laws, his testimonies of HaMashiach Yahawashi, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Others who are not in the truth or think they are in the truth, they kind of float through life ignoring his laws and commandments, and think that Christ will forgive them for everything without even trying to labor in his commandments at all. That's what we normally deal with on a day-to-day basis when we go out and about. People who think they're in the truth. But we're going to go through the scriptures and we're going to realize that in order to be in the truth, you got to keep his laws and you have to know the text, you know, the context of the scriptures. That's one big thing when you're talking to people who are in the churches. People are like, well, did you read the context? You're not deciphering in the right context. So we're going to go through the context. And when you look at context in the Latin, con means with text. So we go with text, precept for precept. That's the right context, precept for precept, line upon line. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. Verse. The right context. We have not learned in this captivity. Now we are beginning to learn as a people in the last 20 years. We're still babes in this. A lot of us are still babes. It reads, "For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifices for sin." Do Christians know that one? They said, "I'm in the truth. I love Christ. He forgives my sins." But the scripture says, "For if he sins willfully," if you know the truth and you sin in eating the wrong things that goes against dietary laws, breaking the Sabbath willfully on a week-to-week basis, the scripture tells you that there is no more repentance for that. You can't repent because you willingly broke the law. None of the churches teach this. They say you can break the law as many times as you want. You commit adultery. You can kill. You can steal. You can do whatever you want as many times as you want and be forgiven. No, the scriptures tells you different. It says there's no more sacrifice for sins. And Yahawashi is the one who does the sacrifice in the king, in the heaven, in the heavens with the Father. He is our high priest. So he's not going to walk over to the Father and sacrifice your prayers for your sins. It's not going to do it. Verse 27, "But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses." Read that again. "He that despised the law of the Most High through Moses died without mercy." He didn't get no mercy. "Of how much sore punishment support you shall he be thought worthy, who have trodden underfoot and son of the Most High, and have counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and have despite unto the spirit of grace." So Yahawashi died, and no one really truly believed in that day. They didn't believe. He kept the laws. He didn't commit any sins, and he died for the sins of Israel. when he said that he was the Messiah. He was the Messiah of the Father for the children of Israel. He was born for the children of Israel. His name in itself means he came to save his people. Verse 30. For we know him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me. I will recompense, saith the Most High. And again, the Most High shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living power, but call to remembrance the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great fight of affliction. So Yahawashi died for his people, but at the same time, he never said not to keep the laws, the law of Moses. You can't despise the laws of Moses, just like you can't despise Yahawashi and not receive mercy. You got to do them both. That's why he said, you got to take part in the afflictions. What are the afflictions? Keeping his commandments and being afflicted for keeping his commandments. You're going to be afflicted when you keep his commandments. Look at verse 36. For ye have need of patience that shall have, after you have done the will of the Most High, you might receive the promise. You might. So you got to do the will of the Father that you might receive the promise, that you might inherit everlasting life. So these people in the churches that say they got the truth, they really don't have the truth, because it says that there's no forgiveness of sins if they do it willfully. How are they going to receive the promise? How are they might going to receive the promise? That's a slim chance. Yeah, so we got to keep these laws, statutes, and commandments in the name of and the testimony of Yahawashi in order to get that promise of salvation, promise of resurrection. That's the whole point. That's what he's trying to say here in this chapter, in Hebrews chapter 10. Let's go to Revelations 14 and 12, because it says you got to keep the will of the Father. And the will of the Father, in the book of Revelation 14 and 12, it tells you what it is. Because most Christians won't go beyond the New Testament to find the answer. They'll stick with the New Testament. And so you have to convince these people that even in the New Testament, that we have to keep his commandments. And it says in Revelation chapter 14 and 12, here is the patience of the saints. Who are the saints? The Israelites. You know, they got to catch a clue. They got to understand this catch. The catch is you have to know breakdowns of people, places, and things in the Bible. So here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of the Most High and the faith of Yahawashi. You see, so we got to keep the faith of Yahawashi, which is the testimony as well. Not only that, you have to keep his Father's commandments, which that is his will, to keep the commandments. To labor is to labor in the Most High's commandments, trying hard to keep them and not offend by despising them, like we read in the last chapter of Hebrews, chapter 10. You can't despise to do evil. We have to continually build each other up, even those who teach, because Satan is very, very, very crafty. He even afflicts those who teach. He afflicts those who are the strongest of us, not just the weakest of us. But we're dealing with a strong foe. He got into the minds of the wicked, and they put us in captivity. So this foe of ours is very, very strong. And so we have to be stronger than him. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 3. Remember that. We ain't dealing with just some fairy tale Tinkerbell. We're dealing with a powerful foe. Even the angels had to fight against him, saying, the Lord rebuke you. You had to speak to him in that manner. Because just like when you go to court, people are afraid to say one thing because attorneys could take whatever words they say and turn it around on them. That's how the foe that we have. Very crafty. Hear your words and turn it around. So even the strongest of us can fall. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 3. And let's go to verse 7. Ezekiel 3 and verse 7. Wait for y'all to get there. Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 7, and we're going to read down to 10. And it reads, "But the house of Israel will not hearken unto you, for they will not hearken unto me." They won't listen, hard-headed. "For all the house of Israel are impudent and hard-hearted." Hard-hearted means your head, your brain, hard-hearted, hard-headed. Verse 8, "Behold, I have made thy face strong against their faces, and thy forehead strong against their foreheads." Why? Because they got Satan in them. They got demons in them. You got to fight against their rhetoric. Verse 9, "As an adamant harder than flint have I made thy forehead." Harder than flintstone he made the foreheads of the children of Israel that believe. "Fear them not, neither be dismayed at their looks, though they be a rebellious house." See that? These people that we're dealing with are rebellious. Our own people can come like snakes in the grass to us. They're the very ones you need to watch out for. Not so much Esau. So we got to be careful and be circumspect in all things. In all things. Let's go to Romans chapter 12. We're quicker to let our own in before they let anybody else in. Yeah, oh man, he's a brother. I'm going to be all right. No, don't trust a brother. Every brother is not a brother, said Paul. Every brother is not a, all Israel is not Israel, Paul said.
Every brother ain't a brother. Cause the color just as well to be undercover. Every brother ain't a brother. Cause the black hand squeezed a Malcolm X man. The shooting of Huey Newton from the hand of a nigga pulled the trigger.
All Israel's not Israel, even though they may look like Israel. All right, Romans chapter 12. Romans 12, and let's drop down to verse 9. Romans chapter 12, verse 9. And it reads, "Let love be without dissimulation." Now, us reading this part about love and charity, and then what we had just said about watching those who say that they're Israel and they're not Israel, that means you got to be a straight soldier. You got to have discernment. You got to know how to treat different brothers and different sisters, because some come as a snake, but you still got to show a form of charity. You got to know when to cut them off and when to be pleasant with them. That's a form of some kind of character, man. That's a witty person. You got to really know how to be witty to deal with people. In all aspects, in all areas of life, you got to know how to deal with them. Because you don't know what's in their brains. And some people are so cunning. Some people can't tell the truth. All they can do is lie. And the liars are the worst ones, because they, if they got practice lying, how are you going to come up against them and you don't have the truth? They'll soothsave you right into something else. "Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love. In honor, preferring one another. Not slothful in business." See that? So just to be slothful, you cannot be lazy in this truth. You can't be like, I'll get it when I get it. You got to have a fire within your body. You got to have a get up and go in this truth. Whatever you do in life, the truth got to be in you, and it's got to uphold you. It's got to uphold you. You know what I mean? Get you up out of bed. You got to be fervent in spirit, serving the Most High. It says rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. All right. Patient in tribulation, that's a big one. To be patient in tribulation is hard. If you have a heavy heart, man, that's being patient in something that you're not used to dealing with. Because if you're heavy in heart, you ain't got the experience to deal with that. You just got to go through it. You got to deal with it. And the heaviness, there's a scripture in Ecclesiastes. You have to watch out for that heaviness of heart, because the heaviness of heart, I can't remember where it is. There's a scripture in the book of Ecclesiastes where it says the heaviness of a man can cause death. You know, when somebody died in your family, or somebody's treating you wrong, or you're going through a divorce, you know, you can't feel what that person's going through. The heaviness of heart, that is something that you have to be very, very careful of. You really need to find your joy fast and get it to the scriptures, because many people can wrong you the wrong way. And those are low times in your life when you're going through those type of heavinesses. Everybody can't say the right thing to lift you up. You know, even your husbands, they can't say the right thing to lift you up. Or your wife, she may not be able to say the right thing to lift you up. That's where you got to come to the scriptures. You got to get that hope. You got to get it back, you know. And that's why the Most High is here. He said that this is our rest. There's nothing else out there can comfort you. So you see a lot of people committing suicide, or you see Hollywood stars doing crazy stuff, or you catching them. They're getting caught in hotels using drugs or women and stuff like that. They got a hole in their heart. They can't find the happiness. They can't find it. They don't know how to. Destroying families. No happiness. People just got attitude. You go to work and they just got attitude for no reason. They don't have the Most High in their heart, or they lost them, one or the other. Never had it. They make everybody else miserable. So yeah, you got to find that strength, that fervent love through the Most High, through his son, HaMashiach Yahawashi, who went through life and went through the worst situations ever, because he had heaviness of heart. That's why he was drinking wine. That's why he drank wine, man. He was heavy in spirit. So actually, it's in Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 4. Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 4, and verse 11. It reads, "Yea, speedily was he taken away, lest that wickedness should alter his understanding, or deceit beguile his soul." That heaviness, bring that heaviness into his spirit. "For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest, and the wandering of concupiscence doth undermine the simple mind. He being made perfect in a short time fulfilled a long time, for his soul pleased the Most High. Therefore hasted he to take him away from among the wicked." So he took Yahawashi away because he didn't want him to continue that being heaviness, and his spirit get altered. He had a mission and he had to stay on that path. And so it's the same thing with you all out there. Beware of heaviness of spirit. Seek quickly to find peace. Isaiah 53. And let's go to Isaiah 53, verse 10. And it reads here, "Yet it pleased the Most High to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Most High shall prosper in his hand." Yahawashi was under full grief, man, in his truth. Man, he was going through it the whole time he was here. And the only way you can get out of it is to have the Most High, man. The Most High is the only way out of this. This is the only way that's going to free up your spirit. Huh. I'll see. It'll come to me. But yeah, Yahawashi was in complete heaviness. And so that's what we have to do. We have to just figure out how to get out of this madness, man. By following his ways and just learn to cloak everything, man. Cloak everything with the truth. Let's go back to Romans chapter 12. verse 13. Romans 12 and 13. And it reads, distributing to the necessity of the saints. Distributing to the necessity of the saints. Given to hospitality. All right, so the saints got to have that hospitality. We got to have that love. We got to exhibit that. Verse 14, let's read on down. Basically, you know, when it says distributing to the necessity of the saints and given to hospitality, it means to practice. Distributing means to practice or to work. You know, you are working, you are laboring, you are rehearsing his laws, statutes, and commandments. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not covet, thou shalt not commit adultery. It is practicing the necessities of the saints given to hospitality. You have to know the laws in order to do these things. If you don't know them, you're going to be out there in the world. Ask anybody to recite the Ten Commandments. Most people can't do it. They're going to be all over the place with it. They're going to forget the first three. They're going to say something about the Most High, thou shalt not have any other gods. But they're going to forget the other two, that the Most High will visit the iniquity of the children to the third and fourth generation. Just because they mention, you shall not even mention the name of other gods. That's in Exodus chapter 20, if you want to find it and mark it up. The commandments, Ten Commandments. Verse 14, it reads, bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. See that? Coming into the truth, like Brother Yahawashi was explaining his testimony of what went down. We're all weeping with him. We're all, you know, we feel bad for him, things he went through. We're all affected by that, you know. Be of the same mind, one towards another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense no man. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. This is hard for a lot of brethren to do. Living peacefully with all men. You got that right now, man. You go to some parts of the country. For example, brothers rolling through Mississippi at nighttime. On the freeway, do you think when they get pulled over, the people that's pulling them over being at peace with them? You saw Mississippi burning. They wasn't at peace with them. You got people who are just bluntly racist. You don't even notice it sometimes. You go in like some of these stores, Chinese stores. They're being racist to you sometimes. You don't even realize it. They don't have to say it. It's what they do, how they treat you.
You drop something.
Just watch. You standing in line at the grocery store. You see three people in front of you. The cashier greets all three of them. Then you walk up. They say nothing. That's a form of racism. They don't want to speak to you for a reason. They don't know you. You know, but you got to be at peace with all men. You got to be at peace. That takes strength. See, this strength is, it comes in several factions in several ways. A lot of us don't understand it. A lot of us don't have the vision for it. We walk by faith and not by sight. What do you think that means? That means have an understanding of all things. He that knoweth the law judgeth all things. All things by knowing the law. You judgeth all things. He that is spiritual judgeth all things. The law is spiritual. So we have to walk in this way. The Most High is going to bring vengeance. The thing about this life is all these things that we have, Satan has power to take it all. This is his kingdom. You know what I mean? He has power to take it all. Houses, we can lose all the stuff in a matter of days. It happened before. Matter of days, you can lose everything. Yeah, you got all the stuff now, but you can lose it just like that. Everything. Cars, houses, you can lose it all. Have to start all over again. I was talking to a realtor the other day, and he was saying how he was talking to another realtor and how that realtor had lost so much, so many houses back in the early 2000s. But he said, I can get it again. You got to have the attitude. I'll get it again. It's no biggie. It's just four walls. You know, the thing that matters is love. Loving the persons or the people that you're with. That's more important than a house, car, any of that stuff passes away. You can't take none of that stuff with us. None of it. Look at verse 11 again. 11, it says, not slothful in business. When you're slothful, you can lose stuff. If you survive off your own business and you are the one who produced the merchandise, if you slack off on your merchandise and no one's buying it, or you don't go out there to sell it, what's going to happen to your income? It's going to drop severely. You got to be livid. You got to be lively at all times. I was checking out Layla Ali. She packaging her own beauty supplies and sending them off personally. And she writes letters and puts them inside of her packages just so her customers could be happy. But she's lively. She don't have to work no more. She got millions of dollars. She could go live on an island by herself. She ain't got to worry about nothing, but she's still doing stuff. Lively. Beautiful person, Layla Ali, just in the wrong religion. Got to come back to the truth. So we got to be patient too. Let's go to Sirach chapter 2. Here you go. Sirach chapter 2. Chapter 2, and let's read verse 1. Sirach chapter 2, verse 1. My son, if thou come to serve the Most High, prepare thy soul for temptation. If you come to serve him, meaning keep his commandments, if you find out that you're in the truth all of a sudden, and your job is to keep the commandments, now you have to prepare your soul for who? Who's coming to beat you up? Satan. He's coming. He's sending demons after you. He's sending everybody. And they're going to come with smiles. They're going to come and be kind to you in the beginning. Verse 2, set thy heart aright and constantly endure, and make not haste in time of trouble. Don't stop. You get a blessing. Don't forget about the blessing. Don't stop trying to keep the blessing that you got. You got to work. If you got a blessing or a talent, you got to continually work at it. You just don't stop working at this talent that you got. You just don't give up. He says, cleave unto him and depart not away, that thou mayest be increased at thy last end. Whatsoever is brought upon thee, take cheerfully. Now that's something. Take it cheerfully. Yeah, you're going to get beat down for 10 rounds. Take it cheerfully. Yeah, you just lost your children. Take it cheerfully. You just lost your job. Man, I lost my job. Take it cheerfully. Once I said, take it cheerfully. He give you another one. And be patient when thou art changed to a low estate. See that? Be patient. So these are things that we have to know. Now, if you're not in the truth and you say you're in the truth, did you notice? You know what I'm saying? Did you know what the Most High said? Because if you claim to be in the truth and you're in the Christian churches, do they bring these verses out? Do they tell you about how to keep these laws? That's the general thing, because most people have heard of them because they have read the Bible and they read right over it, especially in the New Testament, read right over the laws. Didn't even know they read the law, went right over it. Like this one right here. Was that John chapter 10? Look at John chapter 10, verse 21. John chapter 10, verse 21. Now, how many Christians do you think read over this? How many Catholic people you think read over this? And it says, John 10 and 21. Others said, "These are not the words of him that hath a devil. Can a devil open the eyes of the blind?" They stop right there. They just read over this part. And it was at Jerusalem, the feast of dedication, and it was winter. They keep going. And yet Jesus, Yahawashi, walked in the temple in Solomon's Court. They read right over that. They read over something big. The feast of dedication. Hanukkah. That's the truth. You just read Yahawashi kept the feast of dedication. Then came they, the Jews, round about him and said unto him, "How long doest thou make us to doubt if thou be the Christ? Tell us plainly." They harassing him on the feast day. He trying to be at peace. You're supposed to be at peace on the feast days. They harassing him. Satan. How are you going to be at peace on this earth when even Yahawashi is getting harassed on the Sabbath day? That's the catch. That's what we have to pay attention to. He was getting harassed on the Sabbath days. Look at Romans. Let's go back to Romans 12. Romans 12 and verse 2. Romans 12 and 2. Let's start at 1. Romans 12 and 1. "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of the Most High," so there's mercies that the Most High gives, "that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy." How do you be holy? How do you present a living sacrifice? How do you be holy? "Acceptable unto the Most High, which is your reasonable service." A service is to conduct yourselves in keeping his commandments. To be at peace with all men during keeping your commandment. It's a sacrifice. You're injuring your body and you're turning your face like a horse bridle to keep the commandments. "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good, that acceptable and perfect will of the Most High." See that will of the Most High? That's the will of keeping his commandments. That's the will of keeping the law. Let's go back to Ecclesiastes. And let's read chapter 2, verse 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 12. "Woe be to the fearful hearts and faint hands, and the sinner that goeth two ways. Woe unto him that is faint-hearted." See that? That's that heaviness. Don't get faint-hearted. "For he believeth not. Therefore shall he not be defended." The Most High will defend you if you just put your faith in him. "Woe unto you that has lost patience. And what will you do when the Most High shall visit you?" Yeah, what you gonna do? You gonna give up? You gonna say, "Oh, you know, he don't love me no more. He allowed this to come upon me." No, don't give up. "They that fear the Most High will not disobey his word, and they that love him will keep his ways. They that fear the Most High will seek that which is well-pleasing unto him, and they that love him shall be filled with the what? The There it is. That's the will. They shall be filled with the law. They shall be filled with the law. So what is the catch? So we got to be filled with the law, which means whatever you do in word or deed, do it all by Shema Mashiach Yahusha. That's the catch. This is the catch. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. This is a catch too. First Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 21. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 21. Notice what he says in this chapter. He says, prove all things. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Abstain from all appearances of evil. So in order to prove all things, you first got to know his word. You first got to know his laws. You got to know his son's testimonies. How you going to prove something and you don't even know what you're talking about? People in these churches don't know the scriptures. How they going to prove it? They're all over the place. They like old Larry Holmes fighting a young Mike Tyson. Just all over the place. Just sloppy. All right? You got to prove all things. Let's go to Joshua 1 and 8. Joshua 1 and 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee, be strong and of good courage? Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Most High thy power is with you, whithersoever thou goest. You got to be strong in this word. Can't give up. Can't let other people bring you down, because they will. That's why he says, trust no man. Not even your family. Now, they can help you, but the Most High says, don't put all your trust in them, because when it comes to the scriptures, that's the only thing that can build you up. Now, if they come to you telling you about the scriptures, they're trying to help you get back on that pedestal. They're ministering spirits. That's what they are. We all need ministering spirits. That's why we're on this conference call. We're all ministering spirits. We're trying to build each other up. But the only thing that can really build you up is you believing and getting into these scriptures. You ultimately got to do the work. No one has... that I know of have went to heaven and came back to take my hand and show me what to do. The only one that I've seen do that is Yahawashi. And Elijah, the prophet, he came back. That's a heavy thing. But the Most High sent Elijah the prophet back through John the Baptist, preaching the same thing he was preaching before he left. Talking about keep the commandments. You know what? I'm going to try to do my best to keep the commandments to the best of my ability. If John the Baptist came back as Elijah, basically he made it. He told you that's how you get there. This is all what Yahawashi came to do. He came to show us the truth and how to repent. When you go to John chapter 8, verse 32, he says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And then it reads, they answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Yahawashi answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which you have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Yahawashi saith unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. And this goes into Galatians chapter 4, when it talks about the slave woman and the free woman. Because even though we are of the seed of Abraham, because, I mean, the whole scripture is about seeds, but even though we are from the seed of Abraham, being of the 12 tribes of Israel, a lot of us are bond men, because we, every brother ain't a brother in the truth. And you got to be born of the Spirit. And this is what Yahawashi was trying to say. Look at verse 40. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of the Most High. This did not Abraham. You do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even the Most High, because, you know, Mary was a virgin born with child. Verse 42, Yahawashi said unto them, if the Most High were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from the Most High. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech, even because you cannot hear my word? You are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. And so when he says you are the father of the devil, remember in the Garden of Eden, the curse of the serpent was to wallow in the dust. When we speak of the dust represents death, represents the earth, represents without the spirit. It represents confusion. It represents to be reprobate. Yahawashi is telling them, you are your father of the devil. You are the bond servant. Even though you are of Israel, but you're not Israel. You know? And he says, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. See that? That's Satan in the garden. And abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own. For he is a liar and the father of it. See, Yahawashi was born of the seed of the Spirit. So being born of the seed of the Spirit, this word that we have is the Spirit. And when you ingest the Spirit, you have the Spirit. And it makes you alive. But these brethren are going strictly off of the line of Abraham. Okay? It has a lot to do with it, and it has a lot to do with the pride, too, at the same time. Look at, let's go to Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. Because even Paul the Baptist, who was Elijah, he didn't know he was Elijah, but even he knew that our people would boast of being of Abraham's seed. And it reads, in those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of the heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Most High, make his path straight. And the same Yaquanan or John had his raiment of camel's hair, a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. Then went out of him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him. They were baptized in what? Not just water, they were baptized in the Spirit. Right? They were baptized in the Spirit. And were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. That's a big part of being in the truth. Confessing your sins. Repentance. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers. They didn't understand the Spirit. Who have warned you to flee from the wrath that comes. Bring forth therefore fruits, meat for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. See, they were saying the same thing to John the Baptist. We are of Abraham's seed. Don't mean nothing, man, unless you have the Spirit. Because you could be dead in your sins and be of the seed of Abraham. It says, for I say unto you that The Most High is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. You see that? And so this is what being adopted into the truth is all about. Romans chapter 8. Romans 8 and 16. Romans chapter 8, verse 16. And it reads, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit. What spirit? The Spirit of the Most High, the Spirit of the law, the Spirit of charity, the Spirit of knowing who you are, according to the Spirit, that we are the children of the Most High. And if children, then heirs. See, we're not children of Satan. We're the children of the Spirit of the Most High and Yahawashi. And if children, then heirs, heirs of the Most High, and joint heirs with Hamashiach, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. See that? We all partake in the sufferings when we come into this truth by the Spirit. And that's what it's all about. Once you understand the Spirit, the heaviness of soul, the heaviness of heart, you're able to find peace being in the Spirit to relieve that illness. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 34. Isaiah chapter 34, verse 16. And it reads, this is what we all have to do. And I know some of us get slothful, don't want to open the Bible. Some of us don't want to open it until the Shabbat. But we got to open it every day. We got to look at it every day. Make yourself read. Because the world will have you so busy, inundated with appointments and emergencies, and the way the world is, it keeps you in it. I mean, those are spirits that you don't see that's keeping you busy. You know that? This world is made that way. It's the blueprint for being on this earth. Things are going to keep you busy. It's the way it works. So you got a lot of wicked spirits on this earth keeping you moving nonstop. Through vices and social media and taking away your time. Your time, it just dissipates quickly. Isaiah 34 and 16 says, seek ye out of the book of the Most High and read. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate. See that? For my mouth it hath commanded, and his spirit it hath gathered them. And he has cast the lot for them. Who's that? And his hand hath divided it unto them. Who is that? By line. What is the line? Let's go to Isaiah 28, 9. What is that line? How has he divided it by line? Isaiah 28, 9, it reads, whom shall he teach knowledge? And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk, and drawn from the breast. A baby got to drink milk before they can eat meat. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little. That's how we break down the scriptures. With stammering lips and another tongue, will he speak to this people? So it tells you that this is our rest, and he's going to break everything by line. Let's go back to Isaiah 34 and 17. And it reads, and he hath cast a lot for them, and his hand hath divided it unto them by line. They shall possess it forever. From generation to generation shall they dwell therein. So what is sticking out here other than what we know we're supposed to do? Who is the them, the they, and the they? Them, they. Who is that in that verse? Jump up to verse 8. See, this is the catch. You got to know who this is. The them, they. For it is the day of the Most High's vengeance and the year of recompenses for the controversy of Zion. That's the them, they. Zion. It's another word for Israel. Look at Zechariah chapter 8. Precept upon precept. That's what Isaiah said. Let's go to Zechariah real quick. Keep that verse in hand. And let's go to Zechariah. The them, they. See? Now, do you think they will go through that in the scriptures to find out who the them, they are? Zechariah chapter 8. Zechariah chapter 8, verse 3, and it reads, "Thus saith the Most High, I am returned unto Zion, and will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem shall be called a city of truth, and the mountain of the Most High of hosts, the holy mountain." So now we know that Zion, the Most High, is returning to them. And it says that Jerusalem dwells within Zion. And we know that Jerusalem is a people before it's a place. So the Most High used that synonymous with Israel. Verse 7, same chapter. It says, "Thus saith the Most High of hosts, behold, I will save my people from the east country and from the west country." Why? I thought they was in Jerusalem. He said, "I'm going to save them from the east country and from the west country. And I will bring them, and they shall dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. And they shall be my people, and I will be their power in truth and in righteousness." Are the people in Jerusalem living in truth and righteousness? Are they? Are they telling you that they're the real people of Israel? Is that truth? That's why you got to get a clue, and you got to find out the catch, because the scriptures tells you in other verses that the Gentiles shall overrun Jerusalem until the last days, until the last days. Look at Revelation chapter 11. You got to get an understanding of what the Bible's talking about. Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 11, verse 1. Now, this is a prophecy. And it says in Revelation 11 and 1, "And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise, and measure the temple of the Most High." Measure it, meaning go check the people who are in there. "And the altar, and them that worship therein." Go see who's in Jerusalem. Go see who these people are there. Verse 2. "But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not. For it is given unto the Gentiles, in the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. Who's treading the holy city right now? These Gentiles. It was given to the Gentiles. They're treading the land of Israel. They're not the real people. Then it says, "And I will give power unto my two witnesses." Who are the two witnesses? Southern kingdom and the northern kingdom. They got to come back together. Some people think this is Moses and Elijah. The two witnesses are the two kingdoms of Israel that was split. 10 tribes and 2.5. Or 9.5 and 2.5, if you want to say it like that. "And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the Most High of the earth." And you guys know the breakdown of that, right? You know who these two candlesticks are. You got to go to the book of Ezekiel to find out. The book of Ezekiel 37 and 16 tells you who those two candlesticks are, those two olive trees. Let's go there so those of you who are tuning in can get that verse, and we'll go back to where we were. And it says, "Moreover, thou son of man," this is a prophecy, Take thee one stick and write upon it for Judah and for the children of Israel, his companions. Right? It said the candlesticks, right? It also said two olive trees in Revelation 11. Then take another stick and write upon it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, the 10 tribes, and for all the house of Israel, his companions, and join them one to another into one stick, and they shall become one in thine hand. All right, so you got Judah and Ephraim coming back together, two kingdoms. So when you read Revelation chapter 11, two olive trees are the two kingdoms of the house of Israel. The two candlesticks is what it called. They came together as one. And they're going to prophesy against the whole continent of Babylon. They're going to prophesy about the evils being done here in this land until the kingdom comes. Let's go back to where we were originally. And we were in Isaiah chapter 34. No, we went to Zechariah, so yeah, we're going back to Isaiah. Isaiah 34, and we were talking about who are the them. Isaiah 34, and let's go to verse 2. But we know that is Zion now. But it says that he's going to take us away from the enemy. Let's find out who this enemy is. For the indignation of the Most High is upon all nations, and his fury upon all their armies. He hath utterly destroyed them. He hath delivered them to the slaughter. Their slain also shall be cast out, and their stink shall come up out of their carcasses. And the mountains shall be melted with their blood. And all the host of heaven shall be dissolved. Has that happened yet? Have the host of heaven been, have the elements been dissolved in the air by anything? It says, and all the host of heaven shall be dissolved. Like the nuclear, when you see a nuclear warhead, when it lands, there's a huge mushroom. And what does that mushroom do? It destroys all the elements. Everything around it gets destroyed. And the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll. Isn't that what happens when a nuclear bomb hits? Big old mushroom cloud goes up and the heavens are rolled. It's almost like they roll like a scroll. All the clouds move out the way. And all their hosts shall fall down as the leaf falleth off from the vine. Whose hosts? It's the enemies. The enemies shall fall down. All of his hosts shall fall. And as a falling fig from the fig tree. Let's find out who this person is. For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Idumea and upon the people of my curse to judgment. Who are these people? Who can he possibly be talking about? That's why you have to prove all things. You have to diligently do a search to find out who this is. Who is Idumea? Who and why is he rescuing? Why is the Most High rescuing Zion from Idumea? Who are they? So when you are in the truth, you will investigate these things to prove all things. So now if you have left someone else to do the work, like do the work for you investigating who Zion and Idumea is, and you believe everything that these people tell you, and you don't do your own study, what are you going to think? You're going to think that the History Channel is telling you the truth. That's what you're going to think. You're going to think that these Christian channels are telling you the truth. But if you do your own investigation the right way, you will find out the catch. You'll find out that you've been bamboozled. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 16. And we're going to find out who this Idumea is. Jeremiah 16 and 19. Jeremiah 16 and 19, and it reads, O my power, my strength, and my fortress, and my refuge in the day of affliction, the Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth, and shall say, Surely our father have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there is no profit. He said the Gentiles, and it come from the ends of the earth. So if the Gentiles are coming from the end of the earth, now you have to say to yourself, what day and time was this? Why are they coming saying they inherited lies? That the Gentiles said they have inherited. Why are they saying that? There hasn't been a day in history where the Gentiles have ever done this. That means that this is a prophecy. They've never came to a people and said, we inherit nothing but lies from our forefathers. So that should be a clue that this prophecy hasn't come to pass, which means we are all still inheriting lies, which means 98% of the world have not received the truth yet. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And let's read verse 8. 2 Thessalonians 2 and 8, and it reads, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth. How is the Lord going to consume him with the spirit of his mouth? The truth. It's got to come out of his people, out of his saints. And shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. These are all the things he brings. See, I told you, we're dealing with a powerful foe. And with all deceivableness of a unrighteousness, coronavirus, right? That's a sign. Lying wonders. And them that perish because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. They believe in this world. And for this cause, the Most High shall send them strong delusion, that they shall believe a lie. So, if these people, these Gentiles, go to another people saying our fathers have inherited lies, that means, like I said, these lies are still being spread today. It says, verse 12, they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Remember, Jerusalem is the city of truth. The people who believe in the Most High, Yahweh, by Shemamash Gavshai, is the city of truth. Look at verse 13. But we are bound to give thanks always to the Most High for you, brethren, beloved of the Most High, because the Most High hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. So people are still believing lies. So we are to investigate a little bit, because right now the lies are up to our necks. Up to our necks, family. Like I said, just turn on the TV. Look at all the stuff going on. Look at the politics going on. All these lies. Lie, 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 lie. Now they're talking about they found water on the moon. We could have told them that a long time ago. There was water up there. All you got to read is Genesis chapter 1 and 1. The Most High said he divided the waters. Where do you think the waters went? How do you think the earth flooded? Where'd the waters come from? It never rained on the earth in the book of Genesis. So when Noah was building his ark, they was like, why are you building your ark? It ain't never rained. Then the waters came down. They were shocked that it came down from the sky. So it just shows you how dumb these people are. All they got to do is read the scriptures. The Most High says that he sits upon the waters in the heavens. In the book of Proverbs, he sits upon the waters. What does that tell you? That there's waters in the heavens. Oh, we found water on the moon. Oh, what a great discovery. You ain't found nothing. They found pores of water been up there. They got planets just full of water up in space. Whole stars full of water.
GJ1214B is a super Earth that is 40 light years away from us. What a name this planet has. I'll just refer to this planet as Water World from now on. This planet is larger than Earth, but smaller than Neptune. So it is quite large. This Water World says it all in its name. A large portion of its mass is water. Now here's a comparison for you. Earth's water is about 0.05% of its mass, while this planet's water is about 10% of its mass. And we thought that Earth has a lot of water. It is clear that this planet is covered, absolutely covered, in water, but the temperatures of this planet is around 200 degrees Celsius, or 392 degrees Fahrenheit. How can so much water be in liquid form in these high temperatures? It's all due to the high gravity and high atmospheric pressures of this planet. These will stop the oceans from boiling and turning into vapor. Now, due to these immense conditions, the water and the oceans might not be normal liquid water, but rather something called thick water.
A lot of people are believing a lie. And they publicate that on every channel, on every Google station. You know, they just go run with it. So let's get back to Idumea. Let's see if we can match this name in the scriptures with the people the Most High hates. Let's go into the Apocrypha again. And let's go to 1 Maccabees chapter 5. Because Most High said he hated these people. Most High ain't never said that to about Israel. He never said he hated Israel. He said he hate the things that we did. But to this particular people, he said he hated them. That's some strong words to say he hates. Let's see. 1 Maccabees chapter 5, verse 1. And it reads, "Now when the nations round about heard that the altar was built and the sanctuary renewed as before, it displeased them very much. Wherefore they thought to destroy the generation of Jacob that was among them. And thereupon they began to slay and destroy the people. Then Judas fought against the children of Esau in Idumea." Oh, so Idumea is a Greek word for Edom. See that? So the people of Esau lived in Idumea. Now, if you was a Christian and you say you knew the truth and you read that in Isaiah chapter 34 and you don't believe in the Apocrypha, how would you ever find out that Esau was Idumea? Because they stopped talking about Esau in the New Testament and only spoke of Idumea. So how would you ever know that our enemy was Esau? So it says, "Then Judas fought against the children of Esau in Idumea at Arbatin," that's the land of Arabia, "because they besieged Israel, and he gave them a great overthrow, and abated their courage, and took their spoils." So he fought the children of Esau in Idumea, which is Edom in the Greek. Anybody got a dictionary? Can anybody pull Idumea out in the Bible dictionary? Zondervan Bible Dictionary. Anybody pull it out? Or any dictionary. Okay.
Very short.
Yeah, go ahead.
It says Idumea. And again, this is from the King James Version Bible. I have it in the dictionary in the back. That's the source. It says Idumea, the name used by Greek and Roman in slightly different spelling for the country of Edom, are of the Edomites.
There it is.
Mark 3:8, Isaiah 34:5-6, and Ezekiel 35:15.
There it is. The water, I appreciate that. So there you have it. Even in the so-called white man's dictionary, he tells you that Idumea is a generic name for Edom. So basically, what are they doing? Sugarcoating the name of Esau. So you forget. So you don't know what they're talking about. It even mentions that it's in the book of Mark. But it doesn't speak of Esau anywhere in the New Testament except for two areas. It speaks of Esau in Romans chapter 9. And it speaks of Esau in Hebrews chapter 12. And it says that he got no get back, basically. Isaiah 34:5. So you got to notice. This is the catch, man. This is the catch. You got to know these things. Isaiah 34:5, "For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Idumea and upon the people of my curse to judge." People are just read right over that. Right over that. So this is the whole catch. Again, now let's look at Malachi, because he said they are the curse of his judgment. Let's look at the book of Malachi, chapter 1. See, this is called connecting the dots. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. Because people will be like, well, he never hated, he don't hate anyone in the Bible. Yeah, that's the first thing they say. He don't hate nobody. He loves everybody. John 3:16. He loves everybody. Malachi chapter 1, verse 4. Look at this. Now, this is written in the book. Now, I can read this to someone who don't even know the scriptures, who's a believer, and they'll get mad at me for even reading it. They'll think it's coming out of my mouth. They'll think that I conjured this up, but it'll be in every book across the whole earth, the same writing. Let's start at 3. Malachi 1, verse 3. And I hated Esau and laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness, which is where in Arabia. Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places. And aren't they doing that? Every time you see them bomb somewhere, don't they go back and fix it all up 10, 15 years later? And now it's America's. They did that to Japan. They bombed Japan. Now they're all over in Japan.
But from 1945 to Japan's independence in 1952, the United States occupied and rebuilt the country with a heavy emphasis on growth and stability. They promoted New Deal policies to help the economy, pushed for labor rights and unions, and dismantled existing monopolies and overhauled the education system. They also freely shared technologies, pushing Japan into eventually becoming a manufacturing giant, and introduced democracy and a new constitution, letting the Japanese people hold elections for the first time. Essentially, American involvement in post-war Japan, along with their significant financial support, launched the country into one of the biggest economic recoveries in recent history. Today, Japan has the fifth largest economy and is the fifth largest exporter in the world. The U.S. is Japan's strongest economic partner, and as a result of their intervention, the U.S. has enjoyed consuming Japan's exports, particularly cars and electronics.
They bombed Iraq. Now they're all over there in Iraq. Everywhere they bomb, they go back and they fix it up. That's why it says, but we will return and build the desolate places. Thus saith the Most High of hosts. They shall build, but I will throw down. And they shall call them the border of wickedness, and the people against whom the Most High have indignation forever. So you can't get around that. He hated Esau. Then he tells you in Isaiah 34 and 5, these are the people of my judgment. Then in Malachi 1 and 4, he says, these are the people I'm going to have indignation forever. Forever. So let's make this real simple to see who Esau is today. Now, I sent you some pictures from the Classical Biblical Baby Names book. Something so innocent. It has babies on the front of this book. We're going to look at Esau in here. At the top, it says boys' names. And then below it, it says Esau. Language, cultural origin, Hebrew. Meaning, hairy. Spiritual connotation. It looks like a military breakdown of a person. Spiritual connotation, reconciling. Reconciling. Yeah, he is. He's trying to get back. Related names, nicknames, none. Alternate names, Esau. Okay, now I highlighted a section down below because that background story just basically tells you about what happened in Genesis 25. If you drop down to the bottom of this page, it says of interest. And it says, according to the commentaries on Hebrew scripture, Esau is considered a significant character in world history and the forefather of the Roman Empire. Okay, so now you know where Esau went. He is the forefather of the Roman Empire. Think about that. Who's in Rome? What type of people dwelled in Rome? Italian people. So this baby book is telling you where Esau went. Something as simple as this. Isn't that something? So Esau went to Rome, and then Rome broke up into many pieces, and those people went and ruled other countries. They went to France, they went to Spain, they went to Germany. And then they came over here to the America on the Mayflower and put our people in captivity and plundered and ruined the Aztecs, the Incas, the Mayas. You know what I'm saying? Esau. So history shows who these people are. It also shows you who other people are in this book. The name Ishmael. Ishmael. Now, I'm just going to run through this, but I highlighted a section in this, and it says, I will make a nation of him also. So out of Ishmael came another nation. If you look at the second page of Ishmael, it says, of interest. Of interest. And I highlighted. It says, Ishmael is considered the ancestor of the Arab people. So now it's telling you who Ishmael is in today's times. Ishmael are the Arab people. See that? So this little baby book is giving out gems on who these people are. But they tell you, oh, everybody's the same here in the United States. And people tell you that the Bible's not real. But then you got this baby book giving all kinds of secrets out, proving the Bible's real. Let's go to another one I sent you. I sent you another page on Elam. Elam. Boys' names. Elam. And it says, language, culture, origin, Hebrew, Assyrian. They drop down to the highlighted area. It says, of interest, Elam, one of the oldest civilized areas in world history, was located north of the Persian Gulf in what is now known as southwestern Iran. Its capital was Susa. So who is Elam? The Iranians. You have a lot of Afghanis, Kyrgyzstans, because they go back and forth over there. So now you know who Elam is. This baby book is giving it up. I ain't even gotta go deep. But just so y'all have to see, you gotta get a catch. You gotta get a phrase. You gotta understand what we're looking for. I got a book that even proves that the Negroes, that they were trying to find out who we were in the 1800s. So tough, because you all know about the Zondervan Bible Dictionary. It says Negro is not of Ham. Well, I got another one that says that he's not of the Libyans. I can send that to y'all at the class. They were trying to figure out if the Negroes came from Libyans. But then they found out, no, he's of the children of Israel. They were trying to link us in with the Hamitic people, but they couldn't. It's heavy. No, we're going to go to 2nd Ezra. 2nd Ezra chapter 3. Excuse me. Second Ezra chapter 3. So if that is Esau, why don't no one know it? Why don't the churches teach it? Because they all have inherited lies. That's why. So who is Zion if the truth is about Esau's getting out? So we got to know who Zion is. Zion are the ones who keep getting put back in captivity. Because Zion is right by Esau. See, you got to find out all these clues. Wherever Esau is, Zion is right next to him. This is 2 Ezra chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Ezra 3 and 16. And it reads, and unto him thou gavest Isaac, and unto Isaac also thou gavest Jacob and Esau. Listen to this part. As for Jacob, thou didst choose him to you, and put by Esau. What did he do? He put us by Esau. Wherever Esau has been, he has taken us with him, our twin brother. He put us by Esau. And so Jacob became a great multitude. He keeps putting us right by Esau. Yahawashi was put on the tree by Esau and crucified by the Romans. Esau. Zion are the Negroes, the Native American Indians, and the Latinos, and they know that. So the catch now is, what do we do now that we know the truth? What do? We keep his commandments. Example, keep the Sabbath to the best of our ability. That's one of the biggest things we got to start doing, keeping the Sabbath. A lot of our people are not even trying to do it. Let's check that out. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. Because the Sabbath is big. In Hebrews chapter 4, it goes into the Sabbath. How you're not supposed to ignore it. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto thee. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. It didn't profit no one else who didn't believe. For we which have believed do enter into his rest. Now, it just doesn't mean that you just believe and you just, I believe in Jesus. And I'm going to go rob this guy right now. I'm about to go rob the store. You want something? Nah. You got to come into his rest. You got to keep his commandments. As he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the work were finished from the foundation of the world, he worked hard in the beginning of the earth. In the seventh day, he rested. It says, for we which have believed do enter into his rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath. If they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world, right? Because he rested. For he spoke in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise. And the Most High did rest the seventh day from all his works. I like that verse. Most High rested on the seventh day of his works. So the Sabbath is important, and it's every Friday sundown to Saturday sundown. Okay, because, and we're going to go through that real quick before we end this class. So can you imagine if the Sabbath was just one day a month? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine how much pain and anguish and stress that would be put on you by keeping the Sabbath one day a month? You know? You would be so unbalanced that your tiredness would not leave, it wouldn't leave room for your spirit to receive the Most High. Sabbath day from Friday sundown to Saturday sundown is the day of rest, because man can't work 24/7, 30 days a week. Can't do it. 30 days in a month. Okay? Even Esau's kingdom has weekends, and he has a Sabbath on Sunday, so-called Sabbath. But Sabbath is every week. There are some brothers that believe that the Sabbath is one day a week. You know, they think it's a one day a week thing in a whole month. Impossible. Don't believe that stuff. Because obviously, brothers that think like that don't have a job. They ain't never worked. Like I said, because even the so-called white man got to take a break. Let's look at how Paul taught on the Sabbath day. Let's go to Acts chapter 18. Acts chapter 18, and let's go to verse 4. And it reads, and he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. See that? And when Silas and Timothy were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in spirit and testified to the Jews that Yahawashi was Hamashiach. And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads, I am clean. From henceforth I will go to the Gentiles. See that? And when he said he's going to the Gentiles, he said, I'm going to their cities to find the Israelites that are in the Gentiles land. So every Sabbath day, he pleaded with the Jews to do what? Keep the commandments and to follow Christ. Let's go to Acts chapter 15, verse 21. Because the Sabbath, you know, a lot of us believe that, okay, it's the Sabbath day, I'm just going to sleep all day. On the Sabbath day, it's a day of teaching. It's a day of ministering. It's a day of learning his word. That's what the Sabbath day is. It's not just sleeping all day. Acts chapter 15, verse 21. And it reads, "For Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day." So every Sabbath day, the scriptures was read in the synagogues. So how would our people be, how would they be able to learn about the Father if it was just one day a month in the synagogue? If we learn this truth one day a month, everyone would be scattered. All of us would be in unbelief. The Sabbath is supposed to be taught every week to our families. We're supposed to learn the Sabbath, what to do on the Sabbath, how to keep the Sabbath, how to rest on the Sabbath. Don't get confused by these confused individuals who don't even try to keep the Most High's laws talking about Sabbaths one day a month. There's some brothers out there like that. Have good sense in this truth. Didn't he say, "This is the book of the law, and the book of the law will not depart out of thy mouth day and night," in Joshua 1 and 8? So we too are to congregate and strengthen as many members of the body as we can in this word on the Sabbath day. Let's check out Acts chapter 17, verse 10. Acts 17 and 10. "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, whom coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so." So what was the problem with Thessalonica? They weren't searching the scriptures daily. They just believed. They were like what we deal with in these brothers and sisters that are in the churches. They just believed. But in Berea, these brothers and sisters, they was read up. Every day they was reading the scriptures. So they were paying closely attention to what Paul and Silas were saying. And it reads, "Therefore many of them believed." And what was Paul teaching? Because he didn't have the New Testament. In those days, the New Testament wasn't formed. They didn't have a book like this. They had scrolls and, you know, the Septuagint. They didn't have a New Testament. So Paul had to bring what he saw. You know, Paul had saw a lot of different things. He witnessed things of Yahawashi. And he had to prove Yahawashi in the Old Testament to these that believe. That's why the brothers in Berea believed, because they saw Paul teaching Yahawashi in the Old Testament. He was able to show them that Yahawashi was a prophecy, that he was coming. 17, verse 10 in the book of Acts. And we're in verse 11 now. I'm going to read it again. I'm going to read verse 11 again. "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, and they received the word with all readiness of mind." They already had the spirit, "and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so." They had to prove it. "Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks." All right, these are Israelites who were Greeks. "And of men not a few. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of the Most High was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people." What does that mean? They stirred up the people. These brothers that was in Thessalonica, they came down to Berea and caused problems. "No, it's not. He wasn't in the scriptures. That's not him." It caused problems. They started to bring confusion to the brothers who were starting to believe. They brought their unbelief and their dumbness. Dumb, dumb, dee dee, dumb, dumb, ooh. Brought their dumbness down there. Verse 14. "And then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go as it were to the sea. By Silas and Timotheus abode there still. And they that conducted Paul brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed." They were serious. They was out there working, man. is out there teaching the truth. It's a lot of work, man. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore, disputed he in the synagogues with the Jews and with the devout persons. See that? Always, he went to these Gentile nations and went right into the synagogue to deal with the Jews. But Christianity turns it around and says, oh, you went and spoke to everybody. And in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. And some said, what will this babbler say? They're like, man, this guy talking about Christ, we don't believe him. And he telling them about his testimonies and what he saw, how he got knocked off the horse. Other some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Yahawashi and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? Where in the scriptures is this? Can you show me what his doctrine is in the scriptures? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean. Show us in the scriptures. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. They didn't study nothing, but they were just hearing things and just basically what you see brothers on the corners doing. BSing. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that and this is this. And they wasn't studying nothing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with the inscription to the unknown power. When therefore ye ignorantly worship him, declare I to you. I'm trying to tell you what this is about. I'm about trying to tell you about his will. The Most High that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. So Paul was sitting there going back and forth with these ignorant brothers, trying to teach them the prophecies of the scriptures of Yahawashi and the resurrection. They didn't understand that either. So this is what we have to understand, man. This is the catch. We got to know all these things. You know, we went back and forth. Thinking about the truth, like I said, we're going into Zion, trying to find out who Zion is. There's tons of books that you could bring out. I got tons of books on my desk, and I go through each book with a fine tooth and comb, trying to feel and see what these authors are saying. And let me tell you, over the years studying these books, I've noticed that these authors manipulate so much writings trying to prove that the Negroes are not, or the Native Americans are not the Israelites. They try to prove in and out. You can see all the lies. It's nothing but manipulation. And they were never meant to go into our hands. None of these books. They were never meant for that. But when you read it, you could tell that they were purposely manipulating anything about us being Jews.
This is the word of the Lord of hosts. I took you from the pastures and from following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone and have destroyed all the enemies in your path. I will make you a great name among the great ones of the earth. I will assign a place for my people in Israel. There I will plant them, and they shall dwell in their own land.